Big Mike and Hayes Entertainment here. Today's episode, we got an absolute beauty, Jordin Tootoo.
If you like what we're doing, hit the subscribe button.
Hey everyone, it's Jordin Tootoo here. I'm very grateful to be on I Only Touch Greatness podcast.
This is I Only Touch Greatness podcast with Ryan Hayes and Big Mike. We are going live.
This way? Do you want it this way or this way?
Well, that's good.
Hey, that's better.
There we go.
Perfect. Thank you.
Sorry, it's running on Indian time here. I just put in the little ones to bed.
It's all good. It's all good. We appreciate you coming on today, man.
No problem. No problem.
We're going to have to... We're going to ask
how are you holding up?
Good, good. Yeah, everything's good at our end here.
Okay.
Yeah. Dude. Where are you guys located?
Coquitlam.
Oh, fuck. That's where my wife's from.
Yeah, I know. She worked at the Cactus Club with my sister.
Oh, okay, cool.
Yeah. Did you meet her at the Cactus Club?
I don't know. Oh, Jen, my wife.
Oh, Jen. Yeah, Jen.
No, I met her back in my junior days. Her family lived out in Brandon.
Oh, okay.
So, like, she was born in Burnaby area, and then they moved to Brandon when she was, like, 10 years old for, I don't know, 10, 12 years. And towards the end of my career there, we met. And we just kind of kept in contact, you know, the first 5, 6 years of my career. And, you know, she was still in school and all that, and then we reconnected after I got out of rehab. So yeah, all good.
Perfect. Yeah. I'm going to ask you a bunch of questions about your hockey too. What made you get into hockey in the first place?
Well, growing up in Nunavut, right? 10 months of the year, it's winter. So we have a lot of ice. Mm-hmm. And I guess my father was a hockey player himself. So just kind of, he coached us through our junior, minor hockey days. And, it's the big sport up there. So everyone kind of played hockey. And fortunately enough, my dad ran the arena. So we were at the rink quite a bit growing up as kids. And if we weren't at the rink, we were outside on the ponds playing hockey.
Yeah, that's a lucky thing. You had an outdoor rink. We obviously never had that here.
Too much rain.
That's right.
Yeah, that's for sure. That's for sure.
Growing up in Nunavut too, what were some of your other hobbies?
Well, one of the biggest ones up there, you know, we do a lot of hunting and fishing. My father was born out on the land, so I grew up out on the land. Every weekend we were either camping, hunting, fishing, the outdoorsy stuff. And looking back, probably one of the best times of my life, being out on the land with my father, because the guy is a man of few words. You learn by watching him, and that's kind of how I grew up. I'm not a guy to open up a textbook and read the manual and learn that way. I watch and learn. And a lot of Inuit, a lot of indigenous people, that's how we learn, right? By watching people. Some of the best mechanics, some of the best tradesmen out there learned by watching. And at the end of the day, not fearing failure, or that's how we learn, right? When you fail, when you make a mistake, that's part of life. That's part of maturing as a person. And, we could write tests all we want. It's, putting your work with your hands and learning from veteran people, right? Like, and accepting and watching them teach you is, something that I enjoy still to this day. I'm one who likes to learn by just doing it. And if I fail at whatever test is put in front of me, you keep trying. Keep on keeping on.
Did you play any other sports growing up?
I sure did. Like I said, hockey, once hockey was done, we hung up the skates, put our bag in the shed, and we played, you know, soccer, baseball, volleyball. A lot of our sports were indoors. We don't have gravel or pavements for roads, so, you know, rollerblading. It was hard to play basketball on gravel, right?
yeah.
Or soccer. You wouldn't want to slide on gravel, but soccer, baseball, volleyball.
I'm big into lacrosse. Did you guys have lacrosse up there?
No, you know what? That's one sport that didn't really make it up there. Nowadays, it's really big up in Nunavut. I don't know if you guys ever watched the movie The Grizzlies.
Yes, actually, I did.
Yeah, so I think that whole the movie brought more awareness to the north. You know, obviously, it's cost effective. And pretty much all you need is a stick and a ball, right?
That's right.
But yeah, no, it was a great feature to show people how, you know, people can come together and work as one. And in the far north, you have a lot of young Inuit kids who struggle at home, the home life. And when they feel like they're a part of a team, it really brings out the best of them. And, you know, you feel like you're a part of something, a part of a family. You know, I grew up in a household where there was a lot of tension, you know, substance abuse, dysfunctional. And hockey was my outlet. You look at a lot of these young Indigenous kids who have great talent. Because a lot of them can relate to my story. I didn't want to be at home. I'd much rather be outside and playing sports. And you see these young kids really loving their sport because, you know, that's all they want is to be a part of a team.
So what are some great things about growing up in Nunavut?
Well, for me, one of the greatest things of growing up in Nunavut is the freedom of being a kid, the freedom of being outdoors. You know, I was very fortunate to live in a community where everyone knew everyone. I was able to walk the town wherever I wanted. No one was fearful of, you know, a kid running away or being taken away. So, you know, for me, the freedom of being a kid, right? That's probably one of the greatest things about living in the North. And the culture, the traditions that our people bring are something that no one could ever take away from me personally, from every individual that grows up in the North.
That's actually true. I interviewed Theo Fleury a couple of weeks ago, and he was telling me that he spent a lot of time since being sober with the Indigenous people, and he's really learning, and it's really bringing him down to humble.
Yes, absolutely. That's one thing where, you know, our people, the Indigenous communities, when you come on their land, you just feel safe, you feel secure, you feel at peace. I look at my father, my dad, Barney. When we're out on the land, this is where he feels most comfortable, you know, content in his own skin, because you know, that's his life. And I feel that, you know, me playing in the NHL and traveling the world, I've been all over the place. Every time I get home, it brings me back down to earth. It makes me feel humbled, grateful. I don't ever take things for granted when we're out on the land, because the simple things matter. You know, all the materialistic things, the cars, you know, whatever, it doesn't matter when you're out on the land. You know, everyone is treated equally. And that's where, throughout my whole NHL career, every time I got home, I was able to put my cell phone down and just live in the moment out there. And it's hard to explain, but it makes you feel humbled and grateful for everything that you have.
What would you say were some negatives then of growing up there?
Doesn't sound like there's many.
Well, hey, there's pros and cons to everywhere where you live. And, you know, I think for me now looking back, you know, there's a lot of substance abuse up there. And I mean, it's everywhere, right? And, you know, as a young kid, you don't quite understand, you know, the dysfunction that is within the household. You know, I just figured that's how everyone else lives, right? And when I was writing my book and going through scenarios and experiences that I had, and when my book came out, a lot of my childhood friends, you know, were telling me, wow, I felt like I was reading my life story, right? Because you look at a lot of these small communities, kids roaming the streets all night long, till the wee hours of the night, because quite frankly, we didn't want to be home, right? When our parents, you know, were using, and I think that's one of the biggest negatives. It's kind of, I can't really think of anything else, right? But obviously the isolation of being in a small community, you know, you can only get in and out by flying. And sometimes you kind of live in a bubble. And when I left home, I didn't know how much more was out there, right? Being 14 years old, because I grew up in a community where, you know, everyone was pretty tight knit. You just basically are in survival mode every day up there, right? Whether, you know, hunting for food, shelter, all those things, right? But as far as that bubble, I think I really, my eyes opened up when I left home, right?
How often do you go back?
Well, now in retirement, I try to get back, you know, as much as I could. But obviously with COVID happening, I haven't got up there this spring or summer. So looking forward to when all the travel bans are lifted and to get up there and get out on the land and just to kind of forget about life, right, when you're out there.
Because you're up in Kelowna now, right?
Yes. Yeah, we're in Kelowna here. It's 37 degrees. My blood's a lot thinner now than it was before. So when I go home, you know, the weather, you know, it gets to me a little bit more.
Oh yeah. In your career, who did you try to mirror your game after, or try to play like when you looked up, or who did you look up to?
Well, for me, it was a guy by the name of Wendell Clark.
Okay.
Wendell Clark, you know, I'm sure you guys watched him too.
Oh, yeah.
Wasn't the biggest guy out there, but he had the biggest heart. He cared for his teammates, played hard, and that's kind of who I grew up watching. You know, up in Nunavut, back in my childhood days, we only had a couple channels, and CBC was one of them. So we got all the Toronto Maple Leaf games, and Wendell Clark. And fortunately, I was able to meet him throughout my career. And actually, his brother, Kerry Clark, coached my late brother Terrence in junior. So
Oh, really?
Got to hang out with him. Yeah, totally.
And any pregame meals or rituals?
To be honest, I wasn't a superstitious person. Pre-game meals, you know, your plate of pasta with chicken, salad. I enjoyed my cranberry and orange juice mixed together, half and half.
Yeah.
But as far as, you know, when I got to the rink, it was, you know, I wasn't superstitious at all. I like to mess around with a lot of the guys that were superstitious, though. So, but no, nothing really. Just get up, strap, lace them up, and let's go.
Yeah, what was some of the nicknames that you had over the years?
Oh, wow. Well, one, Toots. Everyone refers to me as Toots, but, you know, I've been Chief, you know, basically it.
Yeah.
How was it playing in Brandon?
Brandon, the Wheat City. Well, I think that's where my hockey career really started to take off. And gentleman, Mr. Kelly McCrimmon, who's the Vegas Golden Knights general manager now, was my GM in Brandon. And wow, we sure had our battles, but you know, I think in my fourth year playing there, it clicked with me that Mr. McCrimmon cared about Jordin Tootoo, the person, not the hockey player. And he was the one guy that believed in me. He was the one guy that, you know, gave me a chance to be the player that I am. And, you know, still to this day, we keep in contact. And every time I walk into his office, I have a chuckle because in the past, when I was called into his office, I knew I was getting in shit. And now the table has turned a little bit. So we kind of have a chuckle every now and then.
Awesome. And obviously you were lucky enough to wear the Maple Leaf and represent Canada at the World Juniors, where you were a fan favorite. What was that like?
Oh yeah, I loved it.
I think that's the tournament where my name became internationally known, I guess you would say. And I guess the hockey world knew who I was during that tournament. Honestly, it was the highlight of my hockey career. Representing Team Canada in Halifax, in Canada, was, God, I can't even put into words how amazing it was, you know. Highlight of my career, for sure.
Another big accomplishment of yours, obviously, being drafted 98th overall in 2001 to the Predators. Take me back to that day.
Wow, I've been punched in the head one too many times. My memory is a little faded, but I remember we were in Brandon. I had all my family around in one of the hotel conference rooms, and I get a call from my agent, and he was just like, yeah, you're drafted by the Nashville Predators. And I was just like, wow, you know, a kid coming from Nunavut who, I mean, every kid's dream is to play in the National Hockey League. And just to be drafted is one thing. But it's even harder to make it on the roster, right? A lot of kids who get drafted think they're going to be playing in the NHL. Well, that's just the first step. And that day was, I was proud of all the work that I put in. And fortunately enough, my brother was still around to be there with me and to guide me. And, you know, he basically, you know, made me the person I am today with all his teachings and his just being a mentor. He was my hero. And, you know, I owe my whole career to my brother.
Did you know Nashville was going to be drafting you, or was it a caught-off surprise?
Honestly, I didn't even know. I was just waiting for the call. I got interviewed by, I don't know, probably a dozen teams back then. But I didn't know. You know, I was, it didn't matter where I was going or if I was going. I just knew that, you know, if I did get drafted, I was going to do everything in my power to one day crack the lineup.
What would you say is your favorite sports movie?
I mean, let's be honest. We all know the movie Slapshot, right?
Yeah. We get that a lot.
I mean, riding the bus with the Wee Kings, I think we watched that movie probably every third or fourth road trip. So it was a favorite amongst all the guys. But yeah, Slapshot for sure.
What was your favorite road barn in your career?
The old crushed can in Moose Jaw. Yeah. Okay. So it was a pretty small arena. The boards were like cement walls. And I love playing in that barn. It was cold. I kind of felt like I was back home in Nunavut. And I don't know if you guys remember like the floor, the hard rubber, you know, nowadays it's that soft rubber on the floors. Like back then it was a hard rubber or whatever it was, plastic. But I remember the fans constantly throwing sand on the ground, you know, because we had to walk all the way down the hall to get on the ice. And you just hear our blades just crack, you know, stepping on the rocks and sand and shit. It was, the crush can.
Okay, that's one of my go-to secret moves for my beer league hockey. I got the little sand and I walked through the other team's bench dropping sand.
Oh, yeah. Veteran move, buddy. Veteran move.
That's what happens. That's why I should be captain.
Yeah, there you go. Good leader, eh?
Yeah, definitely.
A quiet leader. Yeah, is the best leaders.
I was telling one story today while we were on this beer league topic, how I took a penalty ref, and it was an uncalled penalty. I got stuck in the penalty box, and I knew the ref's drinks were in there, and I unscrewed the lid. So they went to go drink it, and it spilled all over them.
Just a wily veteran you are.
I know. I like to play dirty. I'm only like 5 feet tall, and I like to hit and body check and slash and spear, do everything dirty I can.
As long as you have a couple guys on your side to look after you, that's how I played my whole career.
That's why we call him Big Mike.
Yeah, there we go. Yeah, when I was playing in Nashville, I mean, Mr. Poyle, you know, I think he'd always have two heavyweights in the lineup with me every night because he knew that Toots is going to do something stupid. But as long as I had, you know, the heavyweights on my line, I knew I was looked after.
Yeah. That's usually how it goes. I need the biggest ones around.
First Inuk player and first player from Nunavut to dress in NHL. That's massive for the Indigenous community. Played your first game against the Mighty Ducks on opening night. What were the emotions or feelings going into that game?
Well, I remember going for my pregame skate, and Barry Trotz, after our pregame skate, said, "Toots, you played this game your whole life. Treat this game as if it was just another game." And when I went home and, you know, had my pregame meal, I, you know, usually I take a 2-hour nap. I was tossing and turning the whole afternoon, right? Cause I was just like, holy cow, like, is this really happening? And I didn't sleep 1 minute that whole afternoon. And so on my way to the rink, my dad was with me in the car, and he said, "Son, just go out there and skate like the wind, skate like you're on the Hudson Bay." And, you know, I remember sitting there on the bench, and all I could think about is my brother, who has, you know, gotten me to where I am mentally, you know, being mentally tough and being able to overcome obstacles. I remember when Trotsky gave me a tap on the back, that I'm up, as I was jumping the boards to step on the ice, all I could think about is my brother and looking up and seeing the biggest grin on his face and saying, "You made it, bro. Keep her going." My first shift, man, I was in the slot. My line mate passed me I was wide open, and it was like the puck was coming to me in slow motion. And right as I was, going to tee it up, it must have hit a rut in the ice, and it bounced right over my stick. And I was just like, "Oh God, here we go. This is how it's going to be. You know, I'm going to get all the bad breaks. The hockey gods aren't going to be on my side and all that." But that's, what I was thinking.
Yeah. Your first assist and point came on a Dan Hamhuis goal, a good Canuck guy.
Yeah.
Yeah. How was that feeling?
And actually, Hammer assisted on my first goal too. So,
okay.
Yeah. So, and you know what? We were roommates. We were both rookies. We were roommates on the road. And looking back, the guy's still playing. He's a machine. Good on him.
You still have those pucks?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yeah. Actually, my first goal against the Atlanta Thrashers, back in 2011 or 2012, the arena got flooded in Nashville. And I never had my first puck, my first goal puck. Like, I don't know, it didn't dawn on me that I didn't have it. But I remember when I was with New Jersey, Mr. Poile called me into his office when we were playing the Predators. And he said, "Toots, I know you remember we had a big flood here. We had to clean up everything. And the staff found your puck, your first NHL goal puck." And he presented it to me. And I was like, "Wow, this is awesome." So yeah. I 10 years later, I got my first goal puck.
What would you say your favorite piece of memorabilia is then?
I would have to say that, my first game sheet, being on the roster, I wasn't in the goal column or assist column my first game, but I was in the penalty box. So that's probably one of my favorite memorabilia throughout my NHL career days. The first score sheet or game sheet that they would call.
Yeah, that's a pretty good memorabilia. I never thought about keeping the game sheet.
Yeah, I've got a few of them. My first goal, my first game. It's quite funny because when I left Nashville, I signed with Detroit, and my first game, my first goal with the Red Wings was in Nashville,
right,
against the Predators. And then when I left Detroit to go play in New Jersey, my first goal as a Devil was in Detroit. And then I go play in Chicago. My first goal as a Blackhawk was in Nashville.
Wow. So
everything just kind of came full
circle. Came in a circle. It was meant to be.
It was pretty, pretty cool.
You had two Gordie Howe hat tricks.
Did I?
Yeah.
I thought I had more, but obviously I didn't. My memory isn't the greatest, but yeah. I mean, not a lot of people can say they have a Gordie Howe hat trick in the show.
That's right. We always loved your style of play, in your face, digging in the corners, laying beauty hits, sticking up for teammates, and dropping in the mitts when need be. Who would you say, like, the toughest guy you fought, or which fight sticks out to you the most?
Oh, boy. I've been in my fair share of battles. I don't know if you guys remember the name Mike Danton.
Yep.
He was with the St. Louis Blues, and back you know, when he was going through all his personal issues, every time we played St. Louis, you know, I'd be in the dressing room. I'm like, yeah, I got to square off with this crazy guy. Like, oh my God, the jitters are going. I think more of the mental side of things. Physically, I wasn't afraid to drop it with anyone. It was just more the mental game that, you know, fighters play within their own minds, right? I can guarantee you this. A lot of fighters don't enjoy doing what they're doing. But that being said, you know, every guy has a role to play on a team. And whatever role is in front of you, you accept it and you try to become the best in that role. You know, I grew up always having to fight for a roster spot, you know, the mental part, you know, always being told you're too small, you're not good enough. And just by the guidance of my late brother, Terrence, being able to just take it one step at a time. Don't worry about what other people say, prove them wrong. Prove them by your actions, you know, because everyone can talk the talk, but who's willing to walk the walk? That's the difference in a lot of professional athletes, right? You know, you have a lot of people say, oh, I coulda, I shoulda, I would've. That's all talk to me.
Yep.
You know, hey, you want to talk the talk? Let's walk the walk, buddy. You know,
that's right.
You gotta put yourself through the meat grinders a few times in order to establish yourself.
Yeah, that's for sure. Do you remember your Matt Bradley fight? You're like half his size, and you put him on his ass.
I sure do. It was in Nashville. I can't remember if it was Brian McGrattan or Wade Belak who fought Brashear first. But I remember a few shifts before that, I hammered Donald Brashear in the corner. And I got up and I never looked back. I could feel him hacking the back of my legs. And I was just, nope, no siree. And I can't remember if it was the late Wade Belak or Brian McGrattan who took him on. And then, of course, the next shift, I looked over at Bradley. Said, yep, let's go, buddy. And, yeah, the rest is history. I think he came out a pretty bloody mess after that.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah. That was a good one.
The video is pretty good. We're going to drop that in right there as we have this interview. Yeah. The what about the Brad Malone one punch? Remember that one?
Brad Malone. Oh, yeah. Carolina. Carolina,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Actually, that's it was our father's trip.
Really?
That week. So my father-in-law, my wife's father, my dad couldn't make that trip. I think there was a 10-day storm up in Nunavut. He couldn't get out. So I invited my father-in-law, and it's the first time he's ever experienced, you know, the NHL life on the road and whatnot. And he didn't realize that I was, you know, that aggressive on the ice until he's seen it with his own eyes, right? But, yeah, I mean, not a lot of players knew I could throw with my left, too. So, caught a lot of players off guard.
That was definitely it. You switched hands on that one, and you caught him with the left.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's a couple good tilts. Yeah, Sean Avery one was a good one. You had a couple with Dorsett.
Yeah, like I said, a lot of guys only look at their strengths of the fighters, which is, you know, most guys are righties, right?
Yeah.
And every time I go up against a guy, I knew I had him beat by just looking him in the eye. And, I could tell by their eyes that they're like, oh, shit. Like, what's Toots going to do? Is he going to throw a left? Is he going to throw a right? And, but, yeah, like, a lot of it is, you know, mental, right? I tell myself before every fight in my own mind, hey, whatever happens, I'm going in this to win it, whether I want it or not. It gave me the upper hand mentally to, mm-hmm. you know, give myself a chance. And I could tell in a lot of guys' eyes that they, when they started second guessing themselves, I had them beat mentally.
You still hold the record, I believe, for in Nashville with 725 penalty minutes in 486 games. And, I mean, I have loved your style of play, the way you played, being the smaller guy as well. Your middle name means thunder, correct?
Yes, it does. Kudluk means thunder in our native tongue.
And that's why you're out there banging and crashing and making all this noise on the ice.
Causing havoc out there. That's what us little pests do, right?
Yeah, that's for sure. That's like my favorite player growing up was always Theo Fleury. So to get to interview him a couple weeks ago really meant a lot. And we play the same way, like the bang and crash. And
You know what? That part of, you know, for a lot of smaller guys, you know, we got to prove, you know, that we belong. And, you know, I always knew I had the scoring touch. But in order for me to have a career in the NHL, I had to accept the role of being a fourth line grinder. You know, I knew I could do that too. You know, you see a lot of smaller guys who don't make it but have the talent to make it because they don't want to accept a different role that they're used to, right? A lot of young kids coming up now, you know, whether they're goal scorers and, you know, they come to a professional team and now they're put on the penalty kill to kill penalties or to be grinders. And they can't handle that, right? Because, like I said, the mental game messes up a lot of kids.
Did you ever take any boxing or fighting lessons?
No, I practiced just by doing it.
Yeah, okay. Just kicking ass with both hands.
Yeah, just give her. Just giving her.
Yeah. What was your, say, go-to music?
Go-to music, Metallica, AC/DC, Tragically Hip. And then obviously living in Nashville for 9 years, country music.
Yeah. Good choice. Well, so what would we find in your playlist nowadays?
Nowadays, I mean, a lot of randoms, a lot of one hit wonders,
a couple baby sharks.
I mean, with the little ones now, I got a lot of the kid tunes. So, I mean, I'm pretty easy going. Whatever's on, to be honest, not a big fan of rap or, you know, stuff like that.
Yeah.
I guess the old school country, the old school rock and roll.
Nice. What made you retire in 2018?
What made me retire? Well, you know, when you prepare and when you accept that things don't last forever. You know, being 20 years old, you think you're going to play hockey for the rest of your life. That's not how things roll. You know, for me, I think the last 5 years of my career, I slowly started preparing for life after hockey. But I always knew what my role was, and obviously the game is evolving and changing. I knew I was getting towards the end of my career. And obviously, you know, 13 years is a pretty good run. I physically still felt good, but mentally I think I was kind of checked out. I knew that family was more important than the game. My wife, Jennifer, she had given birth to our first daughter, Sienna. And, you know, I wanted to be a part of their childhood. I wanted to be an every dayer as a parent. And, you know, I was able to walk away from the game on my own terms, and, you know, it's the best decision that I've ever made. You know, we have two little ones, Sienna and Avery. They're 4 and 2, and I get to watch them grow every day.
Awesome.
Do you still keep in touch with many players from the league? I know a lot of them live in Vernon, Kelowna's, all up there in Lake Okanagan.
Yeah. A lot of guys live around here. Absolutely. I keep in contact with quite a few guys. Obviously, living in the Okanagan here, it's one of the hot spots for, you know, summer living for a lot of hockey players. So get to see all the guys, you know, whether it's golfing or out on the water. But yeah, no, it's
Do you golf Predator Ridge much?
I'll get out there a few times. I live in Kelowna here, so I got two golf courses in my backyard here.
Oh, nice.
Harvest Golf Course and Gallagher's. So
okay,
yeah. But yeah, I mean, we're golfing ever. Actually, I just golfed with Wade Redden and Rene Bork. Yesterday we were golfing in 37 degree.
Oh yeah,
summer heat. But yeah, a lot of guys around here still.
The book, All the Way, My Life on Ice. How did that all come together?
So I think in 2013, I was approached by Penguin Random House, a publishing company, and they asked if I was interested in sharing my life story with the help of Stephen Brunt. At that point in my career, I had been in sobriety for 3 years. It got to the point where I knew in order for me to tell my story and to heal as a person and to, you know, get weight lifted off my shoulders, I need to tell my story. And just being brutally honest, you know, Mr. Stephen Brunt would ask the same question over and over and over again, and finally got to the point where 2 years into writing the book, I just said, you know what, I'm gonna let it all out, because my whole life I was always guarded. I would, you know, kind of mask the pain that was deep down inside, and you know, put out this superficial I'm living my best life, playing in the NHL, and all that comes with it. But deep down inside, I was hurting, and it, you know, got to the point where I became comfortable and content in my own skin, where I was like, you know what, here it is, I'm going to tell my story. And it was a healing process for me. It was about a three-year process. And I think in 2016 when my book came out, I mean, it got some great reviews, and yeah, just about sharing my story, because I know a lot of people can relate, and like I say, every person fights a fight no one knows about until we open up and communicate and talk about our feelings. Things will change.
Yeah, we just had Brent Sopel on last week, and him, same thing. And he actually just dropped his documentary today, a little 30-minute video and stuff. So talking about his stuff, and, you know, we didn't know that kind of stuff until we got to talk to him and we learned about him, and that we like that kind of stuff.
Yeah, and Theo, too. Theo's done books and stuff and had the movie.
Yeah, it's, he's had, you know, a real story. It amazed me when my book came out, not only – players on the opposing team would say, hey, I know you're, you know, I can relate to your story. Referees were coming up to me, coaches, you know, saying, hey, thank you for sharing your story, I can relate. And it's like, wow, like the doors just open, and people, you know, gaining respect from opposing team players, in sharing my story, you know, they can relate. And, you know, that's what it's all about, right? You know, just opening up and sharing that, like I said, we all have a story, every one of us. It's when you become comfortable and content in your own skin that you're able to share your story.
So Nashville did Jordin Tootoo night February 2nd, 2019. What were your feelings on that? Did they make you a bobblehead?
No, they didn't make me a bobblehead, which I'm totally fine by because yeah. I already got one from the Brandon Weekings. I think when the bobbleheads first came out,
okay,
the Weekings chose me to make one, but didn't really quite look like me, but close enough.
Yeah.
But yeah, no, I think, you know, Mr. Poyle was very gracious enough to understand that, you know, what it meant for me to play 8 years in Nashville and to be a part of what they have now, the fan base, the following. I was part of that growing fan base. And, you know, it just, for me, it came full circle. On my birthday, my wife, my daughter, both my daughters, my family, and just to be able to walk out on the ice one last time and say thank you to the fans and the city of Nashville for allowing me to grow as a human being there and to, you know, play probably the best and the worst times of my career.
You probably were the first big fan favorite.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I'm not one to pump my own tires, but
I'll do it.
Like, you know, everywhere I went, you know, people knew who I was. But that being said, I did a lot of charity work in the city, yeah. And I enjoyed it. Me being able to say thank you to the fans and to give back to them by being around them.
Are you still running your Team Tootoo hockey camps?
No, I don't. I gave that up a number of years ago.
Okay.
You know, for me, it's just my summers were very short. One, while I was playing, you know, family's more important.
Of course.
And right now, I'm, like I said, I'm able to be at home with my family and just watch them grow.
What do you think of Seattle getting a team and being named the Kraken today?
Quite surprised about the name.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, I think it's great for the western part of North America to have. I mean, Seattle's a great city. Yeah, I'm sure you're... You're a Seahawks fan, I can tell.
Yeah, I am, big time.
Yeah, so great for the city, great for the Western Conference, and looking forward to I think they're starting in a couple next year, I think, right?
Yeah.
The what do you think of the 24 playoff teams format?
To be honest, guys, I haven't really followed anything. All I can tell you is a lot of the guys that were here and had to leave.
Yeah.
I don't think a lot of them were too happy about it.
Yeah.
But, you know, to watch, like I tell a lot of guys, I'm happy that I'm retired now because I see, you know, friends of mine having to leave their families and their kids. And it's just like, wow, it kind of breaks my heart. You know, a lot of the guys' kids are young and, they don't quite understand about the whole COVID stuff going on. But, yeah, like I said, I mean, I'm sure a lot of people are waiting to watch hockey again. So it should be interesting.
That's for sure. Hey, Jordin, we just want to thank you so much for coming on today and talking to us. And we really appreciate you taking your time.
My pleasure, guys. Anytime.
Hey, thank you. We'd love to have you on again if we get the chance to.
Sounds good.
If there's
hey everyone, it's Jordin Tootoo here. I'm very grateful to be on I Only Touch Greatness podcast. Thank you.
Perfect. Thank you, Jordin.
Thanks, Jordin.